All right, ladies and gentlemen, we want you to continue enjoying your meal, but we do want to begin our program. Haven't you enjoyed the beautiful music of the Strolling Strings? Would you thank them for their ministry of music? And then we would also, and just give me a second here, don't just start in on me, but we want to thank our wait staff, and they are spread out all over the room. So to our very gracious wait staff, wherever you are, would you just pause for a second and allow us the opportunity to thank you for your service? Please join me. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I would also like to say a word about the staff of the Family Research Council, not only here in Washington, D.C., but in our office in Holland, Michigan. You just cannot imagine the enormous amount of hours that go into a program like this, because this is a staff that gives attention to every single detail. So if you are here tonight, you are a member of the Family Research Council staff, or you also were a volunteer, our interns. We have a number of people who all participated. Please, would you stand? Would you stand wherever you are? And ladies and gentlemen, please thank them for all that they have done. There is one staff person in particular that we would like to offer a very special thanks for a tremendous contribution, not just this year, but each of the last 10 years. And to do that, I'd like to bring back to the stage the President of Family Research Council, Tony Perkins.
Well, thank you so much for being here this evening. It's been a great weekend, and this is going to be a highlight of the weekend tonight as we have a chance to honor Brent Bozell. But as we've recognized a number of the staff members and the team at FRC, we're so grateful for the team, and I'm honored to lead such a team of committed individuals. But when I came to the Family Research Council about 12 years ago, we did two small events a year. Now we're doing upwards of 50 events a year, considering regional events. And of course, this is our largest event, and a lot of work goes into this, as I'm sure you can imagine. But when we began this process, I recruited one of the best organizers and drivers in the industry to do these events. And Sharon Helton has been doing these now for 10 years. And I wanted to give a special recognition tonight to Sharon Helton for the outstanding job that she does in organizing this. Please help me welcome Sharon Helton. Sharon? Sharon, you have helped serve so many plates. We have a silver platter for you.
Oh, that's so sweet.
And this is from the entire team at the Family Research Council, your colleagues who wanted to honor you tonight. And I want to read the inscription that's on this platter. It says, "In grateful appreciation of 10 years of commitment, excellence, and dedication to the Values Voters Summit, your faithfulness and visionary leadership have not only transformed the summit, but help to take FRC's event reputation to the top of it. You are a living testament to 1 Peter 10, which says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace." Sharon Helton, thank you for all your service.
Thank you.
great treat of ministry, of music, from all the way to Carnegie Hall to tonight at the Values Voters Summit. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome the Indiana Wesleyan University Chorale.
Well, good evening. Thank you so much for allowing us to be with you tonight. It's an honor and a privilege for us to be here. We are the Indiana Wesleyan University Chorale from Marion, Indiana, the great heartland of these United States. We've traveled to our nation's capital tonight to celebrate the joy and freedom that we have in this great land that we love and we call America. Thank you. You may be seated. This star-spangled banner does still wave over this land of the free and the home of the brave. Oh, America, it's so beautiful. From our sea to shining sea, from vast plains to mountain vistas, from our great lakes to our mighty rivers, from barren deserts to primeval forests, we share this incredible mosaic of His creation. From the north, from the south, and from the east, and from the west, we see the beauty of His creation all around us. Yes, this land is your land. Yes, this land is my land. This land is our America.
As I was walking that ribbon of highway, I saw above me that endless skyway. I saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me. This land was made for you and me.
America, so beautiful, for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than life. Staying united as a nation does not come without triumph, and it certainly does not come without tragedy. America has endured wars, both foreign and domestic, yet this land remains the home of the free, because it remains the home of the brave. Throughout our history, men and women have answered the nation's call to protect and defend those rights and freedoms that we hold so sacred. Some walk among us in battlefield dress, ready to board the next flight to stand in our stead in harm's way. Some walk among us as unnoticed. They carry the satisfaction of memories of victories won, and the scars of friends lost. Some are not able to walk among us, for they bear the horrendous wounds of battle. And some are not able to walk among us, for they are the fallen patriots who live on in the heart of a grateful nation. Oh, our debt cannot be adequately paid, but our chance to honor our heroes cannot happen often enough. So tonight, as the song from your branch of the services sung, would all those who are active military and veterans please rise so that we might thank you for your service and for protecting the United States of America.
One, two, three, four.
thank you so much for your service. As we sing our last song tonight, we have so much to be thankful for, yet we have so much to overcome. Freedom, however, is the bedrock of our national heritage. And our freedom can only survive if it's anchored in truth, His truth. Tonight we celebrate that truth that we have as Americans. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
Praise to Him. Glory, glory.
Wow. If you do not have goosebumps, I suggest you check your pulse. My teeth were itching back there, I'm telling you. That's the Indiana Wesleyan University Chorale. Also pretty impressive how fast they get rid of the equipment too, wouldn't you say? Folks, one final announcement, and then we'll continue with our program. We want to mention tomorrow morning, we have our traditional church service. That's at 9 a.m. in the Palladian Room, complete with worship, and Tony will be preaching. It's just a great time for all the members of the body of Christ to sit down together and just have a wonderful time, the perfect way to cap off what has been a powerful weekend. Well, coming now to MC the rest of your evening, is a man that we all love. By now, you've all heard about Tony's brand new book, No Fear. In fact, it has made him so famous that when Tony was visiting with the Pope during his visit earlier this week, everyone kept buzzing, who is that guy standing next to Tony Perkins? Seriously, it is fitting that Tony Perkins would write a book called No Fear, as he's one of the most fearless Christian leaders in America today. His book inspires us with true stories of young men and women, but no one possesses more courage than the author himself. So as he comes to moderate our special award ceremony, I would like you to thank Tony for all he does to encourage the rest of us to have no fear. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the President of Family Research Council, Tony Perkins.
Thank you very much. Well, we have a special evening in store for you. Before I begin, let me just thank Gil Mertz. Doesn't he do a great job as our MC at the Value Voter Summit? I give him all of his good material. All right. By the way, I do want to invite you to come to the church service in the morning. It'll be the only church service you come to that we don't take up an offering, all right? So come and be a part of that in the morning. This is the highlight, really, of the Values Voter Summit every year, as we have the opportunity to recognize a leader in the conservative movement that has invested their life, not in their organization alone, but in the movement and in the lives of other people. And tonight, we're here to recognize Brent Bozell. And Brent, thank you for giving us the opportunity tonight. And Norma, thank you for being here. And I know your family is here, and we're grateful for that. But tonight is your night, and we want to honor Brent for his years of service in the conservative movement. But you'll hear tonight from many of his friends how Brent has invested his life, again, not in the organizations that he has created, as important and impactful as they have been, but how he has invested and helped and come along the side many others in the movement and in our nation. And so tonight we celebrate Brent Bozell and his family and his contribution to our country. And coming first to recognize Brent, and I know that being Brent Bozell, this is a night to honor him, but it'll probably at some point look like a roast. You just have to know Brent Bozell. I mean, we have I did fall into a few years ago what is the vast right-wing conspiracy. It meets around a box of donuts on Wednesday mornings. And General Meese gets the pink donut every week. But one morning, and we meet early, General Meese picked the time. He was our first chairman. Becky Norton Dunlop is now our chairman. And we meet early. He said we had to meet at 7:30 because no one meets in Washington at 7:30. And he's right. There's a reason for that. But one morning, Brent showed up, and I've made the mistake. Anyone ever made the mistake of, you know, getting up in the dark and you're getting dressed and you get two different color socks? Has anybody ever done that? All right, well, I've done that and I can relate to that, but I cannot relate to two different color shoes. All right, Brent, I'll move on. Our first presenter this evening is one of the most interesting men that I know. Bill Walton is the chairman of Rappahannock Ventures and host of On Common Ground. He is a brilliant guy with an extensive background in finance and entrepreneurship. He is the chairman of the Tea Party Patriots and serves on the board of directors of the Heritage Foundation, the Media Research Center, and For America. He is the vice chairman of the Council for National Policy, and he just recently joined the board of the Family Research Council. He's on so many boards. The only person I know that's probably on more boards is Ken Blackwell. But his experience is one of a kind. And he is so valuable as he is now investing himself in many, many different organizations. And tonight he is here to honor his friend. Please help me welcome to the stage Mr. Bill Walton.
Thank you, Tony. And I'm delighted to be here and be part of Family Research Council. And I'm especially delighted to be here tonight for Brent Bozell, who's a perfect choice to receive the Family Research Council Vision and Leadership Award. Brent has devoted his life to defending and fighting for freedom in a Christian and conservative world. He epitomizes FRC's mission to uphold the family, civil society, personal freedom and responsibility, limited government, religious freedom, and traditional American values. He is one of our most outspoken and effective leaders in the conservative movement. He founded the Media Research Center almost three decades ago, and it's grown to become the nation's premier media watchdog. The liberal bias in the media is now taken for granted. Before Brent, we had a sense of it, but he set out to prove it. And he called out the liberal media, Time, after time after time. The measure of the impact of any organization is what the world would be like without it. Had Brent not paved the way with Media Research Centers some 30 years ago, documenting and exposing liberal bias, who knows where we would be today? I remember reading his work in the early 90s and thinking, wow, who is this guy? He has the media nailed. And look at all that followed: talk radio, Fox News, hundreds of conservative action groups, Mark Levin, Eric Erickson. His work ethic is extraordinary. As Tony mentioned, I serve on his FRC, or MRC, and For America boards. It's remarkable to watch him in action. He just doesn't stop until the job is done. In addition to MRC, Brent is a lecturer, syndicated columnist, TV commentator, debater, businessman, author, publisher, and activist. In 2010, he founded For America, committed to restoring America's founding principles. Since then, it's grown to over 7.5 million Facebook followers. Yet it's the personal side of Brent that I find most impressive. Faith, family, and friendship are his essentials. Many times over the years, he's been a surrogate father for friends of his children, friends who struggled as their parents divorced or were just in need. His father, an American hero who wrote Conscience of the Conservative, suffered debilitating physical and mental crosses. Brent nurtured and cared for him to the end without a complaint. Brent loves babies. He has 10 grandbabies of his own. 9 are girls, enough to field a softball team. He's always encouraged people at MRC to bring their kids into work if they needed to. And if you do have a baby, it's almost mandatory that you bring that baby into Brent for a visit. And he's been a great friend to me. I'm here tonight in part because of my association with Brent and Tony and the change of heart I've experienced in the past 5 years. Today, I understand how vital faith and family are to society and the economy. I didn't always feel that way. Most of my career has been spent in business and on Wall Street. 5 years ago, I had the privilege of joining General Mises' Conservative Action Project to provide the group with a perspective on business and Wall Street. It was there that Ed, Brent, and Tony made me keenly aware that you cannot separate economic life from cultural life. Thanks to them, I now call myself a recovering libertarian. And that's been a great journey. It's not just media bias that Brent is fighting. It's the systematic deconstruction of our great cultural institutions and sources of moral authority. The family, Christianity, marriage, the Boy Scouts, the military, and now the police. Brent understands that the progressive left has an agenda, is to deconstruct and demonize all traditional institutions and produce a world where only the state has moral authority. It's a world where only materialism, so-called rights, and self-gratification matter. It's a soulless world without personal responsibility. It's a world without Christianity. We are all here today because we understand this is an existential threat that we must fight. Brent has been a great leader and will continue to lead us in our cause. Our world is a better place because Brent is here to fight for our freedoms. Here's to a great visionary and leader, Brent Bozell.
Thank you, Bill. Joining us next to honor Brent is one of the younger voices in the conservative movement. Many of us wake up each day with his morning briefing in our inboxes. It's his timing is perfect. It's the first thing I see every morning in my email. He has a fresh and often entertaining but tough perspective, never afraid to call out the Republican establishment. And I will say he's got a good taste in candidates that he supports. Because my first campaign in Louisiana, he happened to be in Louisiana, put up yard signs for me when he was a college student. So please welcome Eric Erickson.
Thank you for having me. I feel a little overwhelmed given the others who will be speaking for Brent. I did call Speaker Boehner and asked if he had something nice to say. He said no. Brent Bozell is such a good conservative, I looked over during the Woody Guthrie anthem and he wouldn't sing. That's impressive. Let me tell you about my friend Brent Bozell. I live in Macon, Georgia. And when I still had my spots on me as a young conservative, I walked onto an elevator one day at Eagle Publishing. They just bought Red State. And Brent Bozell was walking off and he knew who I was. And he cornered me and he gave me the best piece of advice I've ever gotten. Don't move to Washington. So I haven't. I still live in Macon, Georgia. I have successfully avoided coming to Washington for about 6 months, but I couldn't avoid this. I wouldn't avoid this. Yeah, I was a lawyer for 6 years, and I did a lot of small businesses. And there was something I saw all the time, younger people trading on the names of their parents and family. And if we were really honest about it, Brent Bozell could live a comfortable life trading on the names of other people in his family. And he didn't. He made a name for himself. And not only did he make a name for himself, but he made a name for the conservative movement. He's still making a name for the conservative movement. He hasn't just rested on his laurels with the Media Research Center. For America has struck fear into the hearts of all the people who need to be scared of conservatives who have an R next to their name. He's done a remarkable job. He has been a mentor to me for a number of years. The day I knew that I was doing something cool, I was filling in for Herman Cain on the radio in Atlanta from 9 to noon. And Rush was coming on from noon to 3. Sean Hannity would be on after that. Mark Levin would be on after that. And I can't remember exactly what the issue of the day was, but Brent Bozell had all of us in an email chastising us, daring us to say nothing, to be silent, encouraging us to speak up on an issue. Real leadership at a time when a lot of conservatives still would like to get along with the guys in Washington on Capitol Hill instead of standing up to him and saying no. Brent Bozell didn't have to say no, but he did. He put principle ahead of cocktail parties. I don't know that he even wants to go to the cocktail parties. He's a good man. He's done a lot of good for the conservative movement. He gives good advice, too. When I started seminary, I got a nice little note from Brent. I started last year. I'm actually taking this semester Christology and eschatology. I didn't think it was relevant to be studying Christ in the end times, and then Donald Trump announced he was running for president. Wasn't expecting it. Brent sent me an encouraging note, making sure I understood if I did well that when the liberals finally passed the Fairness Doctrine, I would still have a job in a pulpit somewhere where I would be squared away and no one would ever see me again. I was actually kind of surprised they let Calvinists into Washington this week. I was glad to get up here. Brent Bozell has been a genuine guy. Notice I've been talking past tense. We should be talking future too. Because as more and more people check out and go to political campaigns where they're supporting candidates, and they don't want to speak ill of particular candidates, Brent has, is, and will continue to hold their feet to the fire. He once told me a compliment to me that I'm going to return the favor to him. If you want to understand Brent Bozell, understand this. He's true north on the compass of conservatism. Guys in Washington who want to cut deals, figure out where Brent Bozell is and you'll know where conservatism is. And then if you got to deviate, we'll figure out how far away from true north you're getting. Many of the people in Washington, D.C., they've pointed south. He's got For America, the Media Research Center. He's got himself to realign them. He's got the fire in the belly. He's got the conviction. And he is true north. I never have to figure out where I need to be on an issue if I just know where Brent Bozell is. He's not going to let down the right. He's not going to let down conservatism. He is a principle-guided spirit. And I'm proud to call your friend.
Thank you, Eric. You know, I was asking around some of Brent's friends. I said, what could I really get Brent that would be special for an occasion like this? And, you know, Brent is Irish. And so I said, well, some Irish whiskey would be good. And I said, well, I'm Baptist. This is the Family Research Council. I wouldn't know what to do in a liquor store. General Boykin, who meets with us on a weekly basis, is not a problem. The problem is the bottle's empty, General. Our next presenter is called the funding father of the conservative movement. Richard Viguerie transformed American politics in the 1960s and 70s by pioneering the use of direct mail fundraising in the political and ideological spheres. He used computerized direct mail fundraising to help build the conservative movement, which then elected Ronald Reagan as the first conservative president in a modern era. We're grateful to have him here with us tonight to honor his friend, our friend Brent Bozell. Please welcome Mr. Richard Viguerie.
Thank you, Tony. Eric, I'm like you. I don't like to come into a sitting more than I have to. I think this is the second time in 25 years that I've been in D.C. on a Saturday, and I only because of my friend Brent Bozell. I live out in the country, and Brent and Norma have a place not too far from where I am out in the country. And last Saturday, a place hardly any of you have ever heard of, although Bill Walton also lives there, and Sarah, I leave 5 o'clock Mass, and there's Brent and Norma, just happened to be passing through. So anyway, I was concerned being on a program with as many giants as we have. We haven't heard from, we still have 2 giants to be heard from, and I was concerned that most of my material might be taken, but it's only been a little bit, so I'm lucky here. I've talked to some of you here, today and looking at the faces, I see that some of you probably came in late, sometime in the last 5, 10, maybe 15 years. You came to the conservative movement. And so maybe you don't know some of the history. So as somebody who is the been active in the conservative movement longer than every person in this room. In fact, I've been active at the national level in the conservative movement longer than every living conservative except two others. Dr. Lee Edwards at the Heritage Foundation and the grand lady of the conservative movement, the first lady of the conservative movement, Phyllis Schlafly. So some of you might think that the conservative movement started in 2009 at the arrival of the Tea Party, okay? Others might know it was the Gingrich Revolution, 1994, when the Republicans took Congress for the first time in 40 years. And maybe the rest of you say, nope, I know exactly when it was, and when Ed Meese and Ursula arrived, 1980, when Reagan was elected. Not so, okay? Conservative movement started decades before, in the late 40s and the early 50s. A handful of men came together at that time, no more than 8 or 10. And Brent's father, Brent Bozell Jr. This is the third, by the way, if you don't know it. his father was one of the 8 or 10 people that literally founded the conservative movement. And he had a roommate at Yale who who not only was one of the founders, became the leader of the conservative movement for 60 years, Bill Buckley. And so it may be that the beginning of the conservative movement took place in a college dormitory on Yale University in the late 40s. And I think to this day that, and I knew Brent's father, knew him well, he was a friend, and I have always said that I think he was just this much smarter than Bill Buckley. And I'll tell you how smart he was. He had the good sense of marrying one of Bill's many sisters, which makes Bill Buckley his uncle. So I'm saying all of this to lead up to a point that St. Ronald Reagan had many, many great sayings. And one of my favorite is this, says, freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. Yes, St. Reagan, that's true, except in Brent Bozell's case, it is not true. He was passed on his conservatism in the bloodstream big time. His father, his mother, his uncle, and dozens of relatives. So he had no options except to be a freedom-loving, liberty-loving conservative. Tonight's award is for vision and leadership. And that's all true. I can't think of anybody that epitomizes conservative visionary and leadership more than Brent. But that's, quite frankly, just the surface. Brent, I've been in hundreds of meetings with Brent, and he's a strategist par excellence. I don't know anybody that's a better strategist than Brent. He's a major spokesman for the conservative cause. He's an entrepreneur. And by the way, he's just one heck of a nice, decent guy. And you wouldn't want a better friend if you got Brent Bozell for a friend. So I'm thinking about all these qualities of Brent. And I'm thinking, wow, you know, what this great leader, this entrepreneur, this strategist, et cetera. What would life be like if we had 5 more Brent Bozells? That was my dream. Then I had a nightmare. What if we had 1 less Brent Bozell? So Brent, as both speakers before me have said, is a traditional conservative. He's the whole package. He's a cultural conservative. He's a economic conservative. He's a national defense conservative. He's the whole package. He's even a Tea Party conservative. And the Tea Party is, by the way, different than a lot of other conservatives. They favor balanced budget, limited taxes, limited government, etc. And people say, well, that's what traditional conservatives do. Yes, that's true. But the Tea Party is something different. The Tea Party is similar to Ronald Reagan when he ran for president in 1976. In 1976, Reagan ran against the entire Republican establishment, the Nixon wing of the party, the Ford wing of the party, the Rockefeller wing of the party. Rockefeller was vice president in 1976. And Reagan had a wonderful saying. I'm sure you remember it, Ed and Ursula. He said, we need new leadership, leadership unfettered by old ties and old relationships, okay? And that is Brent Bozell, as Eric has said. He is unfettered to the corrupt Washington establishment here. We see it all the time. It drives us nuts. And Brent is not fettered to any of these Washington politicians. Republicans have a lot of needs. I think our number one need is leadership, which Brent represents so importantly in the conservative movement. Our number one problem, frankly, it's a real problem, is that too many conservatives, too many Republicans became an arm of the inside the Beltway Washington establishment. Brent never fell victim to that. Brent is a limited government, constitutional, principled conservative, unfettered to ties of the Republican establishment, which is leading so much of America down the road to ruin. Brent is a four-star general in the coming conservative revolution that's marching on Washington. You're not a five-star general. I reserve that for Bill Buckley and Ronald Reagan. But you keep providing that leadership, Brent, and in a few years, we're going to give you that fifth star. Stay well, my friend. America desperately needs you.
Thank you, Richard. Eric, I just want to be clear. You're not going to get Old Testament credit for that lecture on the conservative movement, okay? One of Brent's good friends, a popular radio show host on the local conservative station, WMAL, and a frequent guest on a number of cable news networks, Chris Plant, could not be here tonight. However, he wanted to be a part of this special night, and so he sent this video. Please turn your attention to the screen.
You may know that I spent a good deal of time bashing our good friends in the Fourth Estate, our lovely friends in the media, corrupt as they are. Well, long before I had my first whack at them, Brent Bozell was busy exposing them for the charlatans and the scoundrels that they are, and I'm trying to be as polite as possible here in polite company. Listen, Brent Bozell has been telling the truth about the press for so long now that no one can really remember when he started. But I know that I've been following Brent Bozell's good works for many, many years, and he has a great following across the country that support him because he's opened so many eyes across America, starting back in the days of Walter Cronkite. Anybody remember Walter Cronkite? The avuncular Walter Cronkite, who was lying to us about the Tet Offensive and lying to us about Vietnam and lying to us about Richard Nixon and lying to us about, shall I go on? Because I could. Brent Bozell has been a truth teller from the start. He recognized that there was a real problem with a corrupt news media, and that our republic cannot function properly with a corrupt Fourth Estate. This bearded rascal running around the streets of Washington, D.C., shouting from the housetops the truth about the American news media, and we're lucky to have had him for all these years. Like everyone else in this room, I want to thank Brent Bozell for fighting the fight and staying with it, even though the going is tough and the odds are stacked against our side quite often. We're fighting the fight, and we've got some good reinforcements that have joined in. But Brent Bozell, one of the first guys at the ramparts, the first guy through the door when it comes to holding the media to account, and I'm glad to know him, I'm proud to know him. Brent Bozell, if I had a glass in my hand to toast you, here's to you.
I would echo that. As we often complain about the liberal media and their bias, Brent and his team are drawing a spotlight on the bias in the media, and it's having an effect, and we're grateful. I can only imagine what it would be like if Brent and his team were not there. Joining us also tonight is another radio talk show host. He is a favorite of the Values Voter crowd here each and every year. He is one of America's preeminent conservative commentators and constitutional lawyer. His passion and intellect and gift for identifying idiots has made him a favorite of tens of thousands of radio listeners across the country. And I can assure you, I never want to be on his bad side. What you may not know is that before he got behind the microphone, he served as a top advisor to several members of President Ronald Reagan's cabinet, including chief of staff to the Attorney General of the United States, Ed Meese, who you will hear from later tonight. Please help me in welcoming the great one, Mark Levin.
First of all, Tony, I want to thank you. That music earlier was so uplifting and so needed. God bless you for that. And what a magnificent organization and event every single year. Now, Abraham Lincoln's Gettysburg Address was 56 words in length. Lincoln's second inaugural address was 700 words long. Two of the shortest speeches ever delivered by a president, two of the greatest speeches in American history. I won't be doing that. But it will be short. I got 3 minutes. You know, I'm proud to have been asked to participate in tonight's event. For all gathered here to honor not just our dear friend Brent Bozell, but one of the great heroes of liberty and republicanism in the last quarter century. We live in perilous times, some would say dire times. Our republic is unraveling. Our Constitution is in tatters. We are surrounded by usurpers and appeasers. And while for most it is easier to pretend otherwise, or leave it to others, or even their children and grandchildren, to cope with the misery that is born of tyranny, Brent Bozell will have none of it. Like the great patriots of the American Revolution who preceded him, Brent Bozell is a full-throated American. He will not bow to tyranny, and he will not make peace with those who do. When the question is posed, who will stand up and be counted? It is Brent Bozell, the Sam Adams of our time, who poses the question. Long ago, Brent determined that among the primary threats facing this republic is a press that serves the aims and interests not of a free people, but a ubiquitous federal leviathan and an entrenched ruling class. He observed that too many of the supposed media watchdogs who were granted special status under our First Amendment were actually lapdogs, skilled at deception and indoctrination. Brent resolved that a healthy civil society required a responsible and honest press. While he couldn't command such an outcome, he could demand it. Thus, Brent founded the Great Media Research Center, which has as its mission to monitor and expose the indecencies of the press and hold them to account. No longer could the New York Times or the Washington Post, ABC, CBS, or NBC conceal their political and ideological agendas as news reporting without ridicule from our nation's town's crier and MRC and later Newsbusters and the great CNSnews.com. But Brent wasn't satisfied. He believed more had to be done. And like other cutting-edge entrepreneurs, he saw opportunities in new technologies, and he seized them. No longer would he limit its mission to monitoring the press, but he would now compete with it. Brent was among the early pioneers of the new media, using the internet to collect and disseminate news. He created new media platforms, like CNSnews.com, like MRC TV, which are today among the most popular successful, and important news sources in the nation. It is a revolution in media that has diminished the power and influence of the old media oligopoly. As a consequence, the public now has untold sources of information, and the Times, the Post, and TV networks are hemorrhaging listeners and readers. Can we have a hand for that, by the way? But Brent is more than all this, although this would be enough. We've all experienced Brent's generosity, kindness, unfailing loyalty. He is a compassionate and decent man, a man of the highest integrity, the highest character and purpose. He is a man of faith and family. He's a man who cares profoundly about the unborn and the born alike. He is a thoroughgoing American, an American for our times. And for these reasons and a thousand more, we celebrate you tonight, Brent Bozell.
Thank you, Mark. Our final presenter of the evening was actually on this stage 4 years ago as a recipient of the Vision and Leadership Award. And on that night, Brent Bozell was also here to honor him on this stage. This is a man who, after a distinguished career in public service, really deserves retirement, yet he loves his country and his grandkids too much to sit on the sidelines. He's one of those individuals, when I came to Washington 12 years ago, was on my list of people that I wanted to see, sit down, and learn from. And he was gracious enough to give me more than just one meal. I've gotten to know General Ed Meese quite well, as we've had a number of meetings and worked side by side, and he is a true American hero and embodies this leadership award. And tonight, he comes to honor Brent Bozell. Please welcome General Ed Meese.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, please. Thank you very much for that warm welcome. Thank you, Tony. What a pleasure to be here tonight at the Family Research Council event, and particularly to have the privilege of joining all of you in honoring Brent Bozell. It's a great evening for Ursula and for me, and it's certainly a great evening for all of us who are involved in the conservative movement and people who love their country. You know, we've heard much today about Brent's many accomplishments. It has been certainly all of the tributes that my colleagues here have given to him are well deserved. You've heard about his contributions to the conservative movement, to the cause of integrity in journalism, to sound political policies, and to making this a better country. I was privileged to know Brent's parents. I met his father when I was in college. I guess it shows how long I've been around. His mother was the editor of the book I wrote about Ronald Reagan and his administration, and a great literary giant and another contributor. And so what Richard had to say about it flowing in his brain, in his veins, about conservatism and love of country is certainly well deserved, and certainly great to see him following the family tradition of service in the cause of faith and freedom. You know of his outstanding ability that's been mentioned, as was mentioned by Bill earlier, his ability as a writer, a debater, a columnist, a television commentator, a publisher, media critic, among his many achievements. But I'd like to go on to praise him as one of what I believe is one of the most important and effective leaders in our country today, and a critical warrior in the cause of freedom at one of the most critical times in the history of our country. You see, I believe, like my good friend Mark Levin, that our nation and its foundation as a constitutional democratic republic is in greater jeopardy today than it has been at any time in our history, with the exception of the Civil War. You've heard some of the dangers during various talks by people today, but as we look around, we see that our Constitution is being shredded and trampled by people in high office, by too many of our so-called political leaders, and by too many judges. Our Congress, in many ways, is no longer operating as the kind of a people's representative legislature which the founders had in mind when they created this country and wrote that Constitution in 1787. We face massive attacks on religious liberty, which is ironic that that's happening in a country that wouldn't be here unless several hundred years ago people came from other lands to the United States, or what became the United States, in order to have the ability to express their own religious beliefs and to follow their conscience in terms of spiritual matters. We've had too many people who have been lost money, lost their freedom in some cases, been persecuted because of their faith. And believe it or not, today as we think about freedom, most of us are surprised to learn that in the indices of economic freedom that are developed in this country and elsewhere, the United States, believe it or not, no longer is among the 10 nations of the world that are in the top 10 of economic freedom. So the institutions that were critical to the founders' vision and that they felt would be a bulwark against political tyranny, and that was the news media and other instruments of public information, too often they are corrupt, they are wrong, or they are totally missing from the fray. Too many of them have been corrupted, and as a result, with very few exceptions, too few exceptions, the people are not able to get the truth about what is going on in our country and are not able to form accurate judgments. And that's why what Brent has been doing is so important, as you've heard from others, and which you know from your own experience in being able to use the facilities of the CNS, the Conservative News Service, of what's going on with MRC and the other organizations that you've heard described this evening. And that's why Brent is, I believe, one of the most indispensable men for our time. He's an outspoken advocate, that may be an understatement, a thoughtful and effective leader, and a shining example of courage, integrity, and dedication. Besides these essential qualities, he demonstrates a shrewd imagination, skillful ingenuity, and I must say even what I would think of as a mischievous sense of humor. All of this makes up the warrior spirit and the energetic leadership that Brent exhibits throughout his prodigious efforts and which inspires so many of us in the conservative movement. Several centuries ago, the philosopher Socrates was writing about statesmanship, and he said that political frameworks are enlarged projections of the soul. In other words, what he was saying is that virtuous political leadership comes from the inner qualities of faith, morality, and integrity. Those words certainly describe our honoree tonight, and that is why Brent Bozell is truly deserving of the Vision and Leadership Award of FRC, but also of the thanks of a grateful people throughout our land. Thank you.
And MRC for 25 years of exposing the bias and inspiring all of us to look beyond what we're told and look for the truth.
Brent Bozell's media group crunches these numbers. Thank God they do. Brent, at first I said, Brent, I know he's an encyclopedia, but he's got this wrong. And then I started looking line by line, item by item, and I said, oh my gosh.
It really goes to show you how out of control this left-wing so-called news press is.
What's our vision? Our vision is so simple. Our vision is one of liberty, of true freedom. Our vision is one of civic responsibility. We do not believe that government is the answer. We believe that we are the answer.
Not once, and not once did you call Al Gore a liberal. Not once did you call the Democratic Party platform liberal. And you're going to tell me that there isn't some bias here?
Here's the last mantra. When your faith comports with a liberal ideology, i.e. Liberation theology, it's a good thing. When your faith comports with traditional values, it's a controversial thing.
I'm speaking here as a Catholic and as an American. This president came out with a mandate, and he ordered me as an employer to fund somebody's abortion, or as an employee to put up the money for it. Mr. President, I'll get around that stupid law, but if I can't get around that stupid law, here I am. Bring out the handcuffs, because you're going to have to arrest me.
The political is not the important. It is the cultural that is important. If this horror story, that is the collective videos that have been released on Planned Parenthood, doesn't get us to stop Planned Parenthood, then as a society, I think we're finished.
The second thing going on is the serial dishonesty of so many in the media who call themselves reporters when all they are press agents for the Obama administration. Something terrible is happening to our country. The radical left now controls most levers of political and cultural power and is using both in a relentless campaign to destroy the last vestiges of freedom in America.
Conservatives have to say to themselves very simply, what's more important, power or principle? What's more important, conviction or consensus? What do we stand for, conservative values or the Washington GOP establishment?
Gentlemen, where promises are concerned, you're not what you promised to be. Do you want to restore your reputations as conservative leaders? All you need to do is honor your promises. They were good ones. Watch what happens. You'll be heroes.
The Bible tells us to render honor to whom honor is due. That is the genesis of our leadership award, is to recognize those that have provided that leadership and have served as examples and continue to serve as examples. We look around us today and we are a nation in need of heroes, a nation in need of examples of how to do it right. And that is a part of this leadership award, is that we recognize those who have done it right, those who are heroes by doing oftentimes the difficult things because it is the right thing to do. And because of that, we're all better off. Our nation is a better place and our future more hopeful. And so tonight, I would like you to join me in welcoming to the stage the honoree for tonight's leadership award, for the 2015 Vision and Leadership Award, Mr. Brent Bozell and his wife, Norma. The text of the award, In a free society, the professional practice of media and journalism can be a tower of strength or a house of cards. For nearly three decades, Brent Bozell has been a watchman on that tower, founding and leading the Media Research Center, the nation's premier conservative champion of the First Amendment. In an age where transparency in government is on the wane and the working press too often trades bias for access, MRC labors around the clock, literally, to provide the public with quantitative and qualitative measurements of the balance, or lack thereof, shown by reporters and networks alike. The mere existence of MRC has changed the course of major media in the United States, producing reportage that serves the public interest. As an author, speaker, and expert in both new and old media, Brent Bozell has provided insightful commentary in the venues from the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal to Fox News with unmatched humor. He is the bane of both the liberal hive and the conservative swarm, speaking his mind and challenging the minds of others. Through projects like the Parents Television Council and service on the board of the American Conservative Union and the Catholic League for Religious Liberty and Civil Rights, Brent Bozell has championed a positive view of the role of faith and family. In all his work, he has emphasized the need for moral character in our national life. More important, he has supplied that character. As a proud husband, father, and grandfather, Brent Bozell lives the values he defends. By his word as well as his deeds, he reminds us all that a patriot's first duty is the love of God and the protection of home. In gratitude for his wit, wisdom, and wealth of accomplishment, along with his friendship, the Family Research Council is pleased to honor Brent Bozell III with our Vision and Leadership Award, given this 26th day of September in the city of Washington, D.C., in the year of our Lord, 2015. Brent Bozell, thank you.
Thank you so much, Tony. Before I begin, a point of personal privilege, if I can, let me introduce some very special people, some of my family members. My son David and his bride Laura, my son Brent IV, and his daughter Sophia, representing her other nine cousins, and my lovely daughter Caitlin, and most especially my everything, my wife Norma. I confess to a certain degree of intimidation by the beautiful testimonials tonight. Allow me the opportunity to try to reciprocate. Bill Walton. I've come to know Bill in recent years as a commodity in very short supply in our movement today. A captain of industry who understands the fundamental requirement of virtue in business and speaks to this truth more eloquently than anyone on the national scene today. Besides, he's on the board of directors of both my organizations. He sets my salary, and I better say some very nice things about my dear, revered, and all-around special friend, and he's smashingly good-looking, too. Eric Erickson. Eric is the conscience of the conservative movement today. Here in the Washington area, we can endlessly ponder and discuss and sometimes argue about all manner of issues on the merits, on strategies, on tactics and the like, and then kaboom, Eric's blog arrive, which instantly and accurately resolves everything. It's times like that that I'm tempted to become very lazy and let him do all my thinking for me. Eric, given what you said, this is exactly what I wrote. Eric is the true north of the conservative movement, not I. Richard Vigory. Richard, I've known and been honored to call my friend since forever. He was there at the very start of the conservative movement. Rumor has it that he was also there for the signing of the Magna Carta. At its inception, our movement had nothing with which to sustain itself financially. It was Richard Viguerie who gave the movement and so many of its principles, including my father, the financial ammunition without which it never would have found a footing. But Richard is far more than a founder and a funder. He is more than one of the best strategic minds in the conservative movement. He's one of the finest men I've ever known, with a heart of 24 karat gold. Chris Plant, is there anyone in our movement more bemused and amused by the insanities of Washington, D.C. than this man? You cannot listen to his daily radio show and not chuckle along. The world may be going to hell in a handbasket, but nothing seemingly gets him down. Then you visit with him personally and see there's no shtick at play. It's in his DNA to lift your spirits. And Chris, you've done that so many times for all of us, and we're all in your debt. The great one. I've known Mark Levin going back to the days when he didn't scare half the world to death. But he's never scared me, and that's because I'm no fool. I've always managed to stay on his good side. Actually, I'm too much in awe to be frightened by this man. There's no greater intellectual in the conservative talk radio community than Mark. His books are must reading for anyone needing to appreciate the importance of the Constitution as America's signature. His show is must listening if you want to understand freedom and our obligation to protect it. Also, if you're having a bad day and you need to smile, it's also must listening if you want to hear the militant left and the GOP so-called leadership eviscerated on a nightly basis. Ed Meese. I met General Meese when I cut my teeth in this town back in 1980. He epitomized the best of the Reagan Revolution then and epitomizes the very best in the conservative movement today. We are all humbled by his grace, his loyalty, his selflessness, and his bravery. Some years ago, General Meese announced his pending retirement, and he's still at it. General, this country thanks you for being a liar. I state these words publicly, but General Meese, and by the way, General Meese will always sound better than Ed. General Meese knows I mean this in a most personal way as well. You are the very best of the best, sir. And finally to you, Tony. I have as a testament of the measure of a man's value. One of the other speakers brought it up tonight, but it's true. It applies to organizations as well. Where would the world be without you? Where would the world be without Tony? Ladies and gentlemen, I shudder to think where our country would be today without the Family Research Council. And FRC would not be what it is but for Tony Perkins, as principled and courageous a man as you'll ever meet. Thank God for you, Tony, and thank God for the FRC. Okay. So the Family Research Council does me the incredible honor of awarding me its Vision and Leadership Award. I'm grateful and I'm touched, but I have to ask, for what? I'm reminded of a dinner some years ago when I introduced our speaker that night, then National Review publisher Ed Capano. National Review was the gold standard in conservative journalism and had been for decades. Therefore, I felt it appropriate to declare him the most accomplished publisher in the conservative movement. Ed responded by laughing and pointing out that for 39 consecutive years, the magazine had lost money. Just how high are your standards, he asked. I suppose I could ask the same question. What exactly has been accomplished with that wonderful vision and leadership of mine? Looking up at the scoreboard, the numbers don't look good, not at all. It seems like our movement has been in constant retreat for the past three decades. We've suffered some real setbacks, and it's taken a toll on our nation, diminishing us across the board. We're no longer the world's undisputed economic powerhouse. We have 93,175,000 people not working. We are saddled with the highest corporate tax rate in the world, not to mention stifling federal, state, and everything else taxes. We suffer under a regulatory stranglehold that is slowly choking the life out of the entrepreneurial spirit that made America the most successful economic engine in the history of man. Obamacare is destroying our healthcare system. Dodd-Frank is a nightmare for anyone wanting to buy a home. The $18 trillion national debt we are leaving our progeny is a national disgrace. Our military has been neutered, and our foreign policy is a calamity. Our enemies are more dangerous than ever and on the march everywhere. Our allies are astonished by our lack of resolve. America is no longer feared or respected. Her decline in the world stage is apparent to all. The pure evil of Islamic fascism is spreading like a cancer all over the world, and nothing seems to be stopping it. Our culture has seemingly collapsed. Infanticide is the law of the land. Tens of millions of babies continue to be killed, their death made possible by our tax dollars. Euthanasia is now emerging, not as a horrific consequence of a narcissistic society, but as a virtuous endeavor. Spiritual and intellectual decadence are everywhere. Grotesque art is called beautiful. Raunchy entertainment is judged inconsequential. Indoctrination in academia is seen as enlightenment. I need not tell this audience that there's a rampant anti-Christian bigotry on the loose. Indeed, the very essence of America's grounding in Judeo-Christian values is threatened. My goodness, what a list. Are you sufficiently depressed? It's enough to lead us to despair. Don't you dare allow that to happen. Don't you dare give up hope. To surrender hope is to sin against God. In my Catholic faith, it's a mortal sin that damns my soul to eternity. To surrender hope is to declare your loss of faith in Him, He who promised us triumph of good over evil. In 2 Corinthians 4, He tells us how we must see the world. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. And in Jeremiah 29:11, He's unequivocal about His promise. For I know the plans I have for you, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. To despair is to dishonor your forefathers. I want you to consider this scene. On Christmas Eve, 1775, facing the most powerful army on earth, freezing, starving, almost out of ammunition, bleeding to death, the remnants of George Washington's ragtag army knew they were days, perhaps even just hours, away from annihilation. In his powerful book, 1776, David McCullough quotes Charles Peel, a man who observed the army, and said of one of its near-naked soldiers, "He was in an old, dirty blanket jacket, his beard long, and his face so full of sores that he could not clean it." So disfigured was this man that Peel had failed to recognize the man was his own brother. Another observer would later write of this army that it was so destitute of shoes that the blood on the frozen ground in many places marked the route they had taken. These men had every reason and every right to despair. Their plight certainly did seem to be hopeless, but their thirst for a new nation and to live as a free people was unquenchable, and their resolve was unshakable, so they did the impossible. These patriots picked up their muskets and in the middle of the night mounted the canoes silently, crossing the icy rivers of the Delaware, and on Christmas Day, at the Battle of Trenton, changed the course of history. To despair is to betray your own children. Do you want to abandon the battlefield? Then do your children and your grandchildren a favor. Tell them. Sit them down, look them right in the eye, if you can, and utter three simple words. I give up. What was passed down to you, you will not pass down to them. They're on their own. But I know us. I know we'll never do that. I know we can't do that. Why not? What's in our DNA that makes it impossible to surrender? What propels us? First and foremost, we have our faith. We're Christians, and we do not forget our Jewish brothers. We know John 15:5. Apart from me, you can do nothing. But we also know Philippians 4:13, where he reverses that proposition into the positive. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Our faith in God, our love for him, and the knowledge of his love for us, that's what propels us. He gives us our crosses to bear, yet no matter how heavy, they're never too heavy. Think of our brothers and sisters being martyred around the world for their faith as we have dinner tonight. Such courage. Let them inspire us. We too would accept death rather than turn our backs on our God. But we have life, so we fight for him. We revere our forefathers. Millions shed their blood, and hundreds of thousands gave their lives so we could be here tonight as Americans, as citizens of the United States of America, the greatest nation on earth, and the greatest nation in history. We keep faith with them, not just because it's a duty, but because it's an honor to do so. How they fought for us, and so we fight for them. Our greatest natural ambition is to ensure the happiness of our children and theirs, and again theirs. We dare not leave them this mess to clean up. We show them by our every deed that surrender will never be an option. By their very existence, they give us the will and the strength to soldier on. They are our everything. And so we fight for them. I will confess, I have a growing difficulty with the term conservative. There's very little in society these days I feel like conserving. But we fight not to relive the past, no matter how magnificent it was. We fight to create a future, one that could be ever more glorious if we want it so. Why can't we recreate and make even stronger the greatest economic engine in the history of man? The founders had a theory and a courage of their convictions. We now have the wisdom and the confidence of historical fact to buttress us. What's to say we can't have an economy where every man and woman not only has a job, but a prosperous career, where one keeps the fruits of his labors, not just as a reward, but as an inherent right? What's to say we can't restore all of our freedoms to live, to go, to speak, to think, and pray as we please, while reestablishing the imperative that the federal government is forbidden by law from transgressing its enumerated powers? What's to stop us if we want it badly enough? Tell me, why can't we again be the leader of the free world? Why can't we possess the most powerful military on earth with a natural reluctance to ever use it unless threatened, in which case our response will be as ferocious as it is decisive, in a world where our enemies fear us and our friends not only respect us, but show gratitude for our goodness? And why can't we have a world where terrorists reside in the deepest recesses of the darkest of caves, under the rubble? What's to stop us if we want it badly enough? But to be great, we must be good. And I want America to be good again. I want the great stain on our national soul to be erased, which will happen the day we ban forever the slaughter of the unborn. And and replace that terrible sin, not just with a respect for, but a joyful celebration of life in all its forms until natural death. I want innocence. I want innocence restored to our children. I want our nation to again embrace the Judeo-Christian heritage. I want our churches once more to grace the village square and be the cornerstone of our daily life, invited and inviting in a society where government doesn't control religion, religion guides government. Why can't we do it? What's to stop us if we want it badly enough? You and I want America again to be the most envied, the most prosperous, the most noble, the most generous, the mightiest, the freest, and the most virtuous nation on earth. A tall order? Not really. Not if we want it badly enough. Ladies and gentlemen, let us want it badly enough. That is my hope, and that is my plea. Thank you again for this honor.
Thank all of you for being a part of this special night and this weekend of the Values Voter Summit. Coming now to close us and provide our benediction, the Reverend Wren Brookhuysen comes, and then the choir will come back as we conclude our evening with God Bless America.
Well, I've been reading Tony's new book, No Fear. And it's, as I expected from Tony, an excellent book. The only thing that puzzled me was the title. I thought coming from Louisiana, it would probably be something like, Ain't Scared. Actually, on my iPhone, I have a wordometer app and measured all the words that were spoken this weekend. 18.5 trillion. Tonight, I want to leave you with one word. There are some speeches that are 700 words long. There are some that are 54 words long. Tonight, if you would just remember one word. The Apostle Paul was on another missionary journey, and he wanted to move on as he always did. A year and a half in one place was long for him. And he wrote to the church in Corinth when he was in the city of Ephesus. He said, there's a wide open door for my work, and there are many who oppose me. Did you pick up on that when you read it in the Bible? There's a wide open door for my work, and there are many who oppose me. He didn't say but. But is a big eraser. I really like you, but. You did a good job, but. Paul did not say, I have a great opportunity, but you know what? There are a lot who oppose me, and I might not get to it. What a faith there was in that word. I have an open door, and there are many who oppose me. And the strength that he had goes all the way back to roots in the Old Testament when God's people were being severely tried. During the time of the prophet Isaiah, 80% of the country had been carried away as prisoners of war. That left just a miserable 20%. And in times like that, Isaiah stood up with a word from the Lord, and that's the word that I want to leave with you tonight. So if you would rise to receive it, I'd like to give it to you. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is upon you. Look, the earth is covered with darkness and heavy darkness over the people. But the Lord shines on you, and his glory hovers over you. No weapon that is forged against you shall prosper. And you will refute every voice that stands up to accuse you. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their vindication comes from me, declares the Lord. Amen.
Please join us in singing God Bless America.
God bless.
And this adjourns the 2015 Values Voter Summit. Good night and God bless.